Today in Matters of Fact, the House of Representatives set to investigate the death of a first-year cadet at the Philippine Military Academy, allegedly because of hazing. Now, just last year, the death of USC Law student Horacio Atio Castillo III, also due to hazing, led to a stronger law penalizing this violent initiation rite common in fraternities and sororities. So what else can institutions do other than strictly implement the law? Joining us today from our Rockwell studio, Cagayan de Oro Representative Rufus Rodriguez. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Christian.
Okay, this House investigation that is set to take place, when will this happen?
Well, I filed the resolution last Friday. It will be read by first reading at 3 o'clock this afternoon, so probably next week, given the 3 days notice rule. When we invite the PMA superintendent, those who are in charge of the PMA cadets, and also the parents of Darwin Dormitorio.
Okay. Now, of course, this investigation will be in aid of legislation, but we know that last year, the Philippine Congress, and then the law was signed by the president, that particular law actually strengthened the existing law against hazing. So what else do you hope to achieve in this investigation?
Yes, actually, we already have a very strong anti-hazing law because the Republic Act 8049, which was the anti-hazing law of 1995, has already been amended, strengthened by Republic Act 11053, which was just last year. But still, there is a possibility that we will elevate this crime into a heinous crime, into a definition one of the heinous crimes. Although right now the penalty already is reclusion perpetua, it's already life imprisonment plus 3 million pesos in terms of a fine if death occurs, like in this case of Darwin Dormitorio, Christian.
So precisely the point. Now, if you classify hazing as a heinous crime, what will be the difference there?
The difference will be, first, they will not be eligible for a good conduct time allowance because that is an exemption. They will have to serve the entire life imprisonment that will be meted to them. No more good conduct time allowance. To serve as an example, as a deterrent, because it seems that the new law last year did not deter people, like in the case of the PMA. I don't know how come it can still happen when Republic Act 11053 is a law prohibiting hazing. And hazing refers to any act in the law, Section 1, it refers to any act that will result in physical or psychological suffering, harm, or injury to an applicant or a neophyte joining a fraternity, sorority, or organization. It is very clear there. And even cases of embarrassment that is being done as a mental torture to these applicants are already prohibited. And if death, sodomy, and insanity results in this particular hazing, it is life imprisonment plus 3 million fine. And going down the line, if the injury is for 30 days, if he lost a foot, an eye, and so forth, so really it is already very much strengthened.
Yeah,
So
the law is very strict as it is. So
very strict already as it is. Except that it's not a heinous crime as of now.
Yeah. So do you think there's really a problem with the law, or the problem is with the implementation?
There is no problem with the law. That is why it has to be followed. It is very, very clear. The prohibitions on hazing is clear under the law. The penalties are very clear. The process of having an initiation, you have to write 7 days before the initiation to the school official, in this case, the PMA superintendent, Lieutenant General Ronnie Evangelista. And you have to write to him, and the school head will have to assign 2 of his representatives to be present in any kind of initiation. Because initiation is still allowed as long as it is not hazing. There is no physical or psychological suffering or harm or injury done to the neophytes. And these representatives should be the ones present there, and they should prevent any untoward incident, like it may go to harm. They have to stop it, and then they have to report to the school authority head. So why has this happened? So therefore, there is command responsibility here. And in, especially in the PMA, we are training our future officers in the armed forces. And yet, person like Darwin Dormitorio from Cagayan de Oro, my city, has died, a young person who wishes to become a military officer and probably go up the ranks and do good service to the country. All the dreams of Darwin has died with him.
Now, speaking of command responsibility, I think a few days ago you mentioned the need for the superintendent of the Philippine Military Academy to step down?
Immediately. He has not been able to comply with the law. He has not been able to regulate the initiation. He should have, in the very first place, he would have known that there will be things happening in his own academy. And so therefore, Lieutenant General Ronnie Evangelista should now resign. Let us have somebody there who will strictly follow the law. Otherwise, there will be more deaths than this one. If the PMA continues with this practice under the noses of the heads of the institution and is blind on this, it cannot be that he would not know, because it's a small community. He would hear. They are already the military. They will have intelligence in the PMA itself. So therefore, he has failed in that. And so let us give it to someone who can stop this tradition, which has been declared illegal, hazing not only in the PMA, but also in all schools and even community-based organizations. Yeah. It is now part of the law, community-based organizations. So now, that course, is what should happen.
Of course, one school of thought here is this. Since it happened in a government institution, the Philippine Military Academy, they should have been more strict in implementing the law. But on the other hand,
I agree with that.
Yeah, but on the other hand, even graduates of the PMA who are now in government, some of them in the Senate, they say that that's part of the culture. So how do you balance those things? How do you deal with that particular perspective?
That culture, that tradition, that law of the jungle, that hazing should already stop. There's already a law, the anti-hazing law of 2018. If we do not stop now, when will we stop? There will be more deaths. 2018, the death of Otto Castillo, a law student in UST. So here, it happens. That was just last year. Now, in another year, somebody has died already, Darwin Dormitorio. So the more it should be strict in terms of the compliance of the Republic Act 1053 by the Philippine Military Academy, that kind of a tradition should stop. Otherwise, deaths will occur really in the future.
But how do you balance the need to also toughen the cadets? Because this is what we're hearing also from those who are talking about the so-called culture or tradition within the PMA.
You toughen them by rigorous exercises. You toughen them by their physical improvement in their physique. The stamina, how do you do that? You run so many times in the morning. You go on a strict regimen of really physical strength. But, to hit somebody repeatedly on the stomach that led to internal hemorrhage, that is the cause for the cardiac arrest, according to the PMA doctor, certainly is not the right kind of initiation. That should already be stopped. That is the law, and we should follow that.
Yeah, Congressman Rufus, I'm also curious regarding your own experience when you were at law school. Did you also experience some form of hazing? And how did you deal with this? I'm asking this question because that's also part of the conversation, how the people, the students involved, should react in the face of possible initiation rights. In your case, did you experience that?
I have never been a member of any fraternity. UP College of Law is very well known for very strong fraternities. But I never joined because I never accept the fact that you will be hit somewhere in your body to become a member. That is crazy. You are there in the law school to study and to be able to finish law school and to become a lawyer. So never. So I am called, therefore, in UP as a barbarian. I never joined. And I, to me, it's also good. You know why? Because you are a friend to all. your classmates and your schoolmates because you don't belong to a fraternity. So when I became Law Dean of San Sebastian, I got everyone from different fraternities to teach in San Sebastian because I have no loyalty to one organization. So I never experienced that. And I believe that should be the mind of every student. Never join, in fact, this fraternity, which will have hazing. And therefore, if we, you know, if we continue to have students joining fraternities, and that is really hazing, there will be no end to these deaths that will follow.
Now, do you think there are enough safeguards in the law to somehow lead to a change in tradition or culture among fraternities? For example, in law schools, for example, in the PMA, because you know for a fact that there's the so-called brotherhood mentality. They keep quiet, they protect one another.
The brotherhood mentality should always be there. When you become a military officer, you are not only loyal to your corps. You are loyal to the Filipino people because you are the protector of the Filipino people if you join the armed forces. So what is this kalokohan that you have to be hit, you have to be, you know, to be hospitalized, you have to, you know, you don't go to class for 7 days because you're really the paddling. This, all of these things will really make you not unable to go to school. This has to stop already. And the way to have camaraderie is being together, eating together, sharing together, and that is how it should be.
Now, I understand you are in touch with the family of the victim, Mr. Dormitorio. So what do we know so far? Not yet.
We have not yet been able because we don't want to interfere yet with the grief. And so we will this today because it just happened last
Saturday.
Friday morning. So we are trying to give them space. And then now today we're going to get in touch with them because when the hearing comes, I would invite them to come to Cagayan de Oro, to Manila, Batasan for the hearing.
But what do we know so far? Because another perspective is that this might not have been a case of hazing also.
Impossible.
Based on what you know so far, it's actually hazing.
Based on what we know, it's the PMA doctor. The PMA doctor said it is the cause of death of Darwin Dormitorio is cardiac arrest due to resulting from internal hemorrhage. And internal hemorrhage is caused by blunt instrument being hit on his stomach. The kidney, all the internal organs had been affected. That is an official PMA announcement.
And so far, based on what the PMA officials have been doing, do you think they're on the right track when it comes to holding those who were responsible accountable? They have identified at least three suspects, I understand.
That is really just a small act that they have done. I don't want the PMA or the armed forces to investigate this. It should be the NBI because they belong to one group. They belong to one PMA. Who should be investigated? Not only these three, first class or fourth year, two third class or second year cadets. It will not end there. We should go to the very top, the PMA superintendent himself and those faculty members who are really involved here because this cannot happen without the knowledge of even the advisors of the cadets. And so it should not be an investigation only by the armed forces of General Madrigal. No, it should be an outside investigation. It may even be a task force between the NBI and the police. Never involve the PMA itself. They are the ones at fault in this case.
But of course, you would also need their cooperation somehow because they have the details, they have the documents perhaps. They have the account of those witnesses who probably saw the incident. So they have no choice but to get their cooperation.
They could not cooperate because they are the ones involved. The authorities there are involved. How can this happen in that campus? That's a live-in campus. They stay there. The cadets stay there. So therefore, there has to be an independent investigation, not by the PMA, not by the Armed Forces of the Philippines, but by the NBI and the police. So that an outside will go there. They would know what to do because the power to investigate. So therefore, that should be done. An outside investigator because we want this to stop in the PMA, including the officials of the PMA should be the ones investigated, not only the cadets.
Okay, now finally on this point, you mentioned the need to classify hazing as a heinous crime. What other improvements are you seeing when it comes to the law that was already strengthened last year?
Well, practically, it's already very, very much strong. In itself, it can really stand because it's already the highest penalty, which is reclusion perpetua, life imprisonment. And there's an additional of 3 million pesos in fine. But how can 3 million, you know, raise, you know, it's already a death. So it's really more now on raising it to a heinous crime category. So that in heinous crimes, there will be no more good conduct. They are going to stay in jail. That will serve as an example to all organizations, all fraternities, all sororities in this country.
Okay, let's move on to the other topic. The Palace Memorandum allegedly suspending all negotiations, suspending or refusing to accept all loans, grants, or aid coming from those 18 countries that supported the Iceland resolution calling for a comprehensive study and report into the conduct of the drug war here in the Philippines. Now, is this something that we should be bothered about, or is this a good decision by Malacañang?
I believe that Malacañang should rescind that memorandum. It is not good for our country. We're going to lose billions of pesos that will come from the 18 countries. Australia is part of it, and the others, big countries, which are donors to our country. And so our country still needs all of the support. There are many of this particular aid going to Mindanao, in the peace process of Mindanao, in the development of the indigenous in Mindanao, in the development of the economy of the country. So therefore, it's a knee-jerk reaction to the fact that a resolution was approved. But, you know, countries can do that. Precisely, there are norms of international law, and they believe so, 18 of them. Others did not believe in them. We do not believe also that there should be interference. But you do not just, prevent anymore the negotiations for this kind of aid to come. I think Malacañang should be better advised to rescind this. Let's continue talking to them. Let us defend, you know, the palace should defend its anti-drug campaign and be able to just continue. You know, the resolution has been passed, so that's it. So we are saying, the palace is saying that right now, for example, the Filipino people supports the drug campaign. Clearly, excellent rating in the latest survey. So these are the things that should be taken. But to just rescind all of this is not good for our country. We still need those aid and support from the 18 countries that voted yes for that resolution on the drug scenario in the Philippines.
In the first place, should the Duterte administration be offended by that resolution? Because I was checking the language of that resolution. It said, take all necessary measures to prevent extrajudicial killings and enforce disappearances, carry out impartial investigations, and hold perpetrators accountable. So is this something that the Duterte administration, in the first place, should have been offended over?
No. As you have read, certainly it just calls on our country to make the proper investigations, to do what is necessary, to prevent extrajudicial killings. All of this is a more advisory. It is not compelling because a resolution cannot compel a government to act. It just advises, proposes to our government to be able to be more transparent. There should be measures to be able to prevent extrajudicial killings in the fight against drugs. So it's not derogatory. It is something advisory. And of course, our government can be able to come out and to be able squarely to implement the rules that it believes that it will not, that we will comply, or we will at least be able to address the concerns of these 18 countries, Christian.
Because some of those who are defending the Malacañang reaction to this particular resolution are claiming that this was an affront to Philippine sovereignty, the fact that the Philippine government should decide on how to run this government.
No, it is not. It is merely recommendatory. Because international proposals like this through a resolution by these countries are really advisory, recommendatory. So we have to really also defend the government must defend its action in this drive campaign, and they can do that. But to stop negotiations for all of these loans, we need these loans, we need these grants, we need all of the assistance from any from all of these countries, because we are needing them in our economic development, in our peace process, and everything.
Now, do you think, in the first place, the administration should just somehow cooperate in certain areas when it comes to actually allowing the international community to look into the drug war? Is that a good recourse?
I believe, yes, we have to be transparent. The government should be able to defend its program. That is the point. You are the government. There is a program, there is a fight against drugs in this country. Now we have to defend the processes, we have to defend the results, and therefore it's just really in the international community, they're concerned about human rights, and everybody should be, including our country. We cannot go beyond what is the protection of human rights in our country, and the government should be able to defend its actions on this score. But we cannot make enemies of 18 countries. We will need them not only in this law, in these grants, but we need them in other international decision making in the international community. We cannot be an island by ourselves, the Philippines. Imagine you ostracize 18 countries already, and these are big countries. And so we need them diplomatically for our political advancement internationally. We still need them, and so therefore we should be able to work with them, especially in the grants and loans that they are giving to us.
As a final point, Congressman Rufus Rodriguez, because others are saying perhaps what if the drug war, the approach itself by this administration, is not defensible in the first place? That's where the problem might be.
Well, there have been cases filed. And we all know that there have been cases of those who were killed who allegedly nanlaban, but some cases have been filed. Probably the government should also file in other cases where there is belief that there is no, there was really a no reason to kill these drug pushers. So the government should defend itself. And it should not go through being, canceling grants from other countries. If they can make that, there are many cases already filed. Many already police officers have been hailed to the courts. And so that is what should be done.
Okay. Congressman Rufus Rodriguez, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Christian. Good morning. Thank you.